I am a fighter, been a fighter all my life. I'm in the healthcare field. I help people every day. I love what I do, but I no longer can fight this battle of Baltimore City. I can't sacrifice my 11-year-old son, nor my 16-year-old son that attends Edmondson High School, a straight A student. He loves what he does. He loves his teachers. I have to strip my children from the life that they know, because I cannot risk their life. I love Baltimore City, but I'm not willing to sacrifice the life of my children for this city.
That was a mom who clearly had enough yesterday, and she talked to several different news organizations, and the same message that not going to take it anymore. It's out of control. Five teenagers shot, one killed, a 16-year-old killed in the shopping center in Edmondson Village Shopping Center, right across the street from Edmondson High School, and they were all students there. 20 rounds fired. Two shooters, apparently. The victims, two 17-year-olds, two 18-year-olds, and the 16-year-old who was killed, who wound up dying at shock trauma. The shots were fired at 11:18 in the morning. Classes obviously canceled today, and they were let out school yesterday. They were at the Popeyes for lunch, apparently. Left the school, went to the Popeyes. That's where the shooting took place. And that became somewhat of a story because the mayor was not quite happy with what was going on at the shopping center because they've been told not to sell to minors.
This is the kind of thing that happens when you have derelict ownership that disinvests, businesses that are not connected or don't really care about the community. This Popeyes has been cited before for selling to minors and students during the daytime. This is something that shouldn't happen because those young people wouldn't be here if they knew they couldn't buy something from this place.
Well, they also should have been in school.
But that's a problem, and I'm not suggesting in any shape, form, or fashion. And I said before, Brian, we do have a curfew in the city during the daytime for students to be going to establishments. I say it happens at Mondawmin Mall. They don't allow students from Douglas to come in. It's all different places. However, that is not the overwhelming issue. We're talking about this year, everyone. The first 5 days of this year, a 16-year-old shot and killed, a 17-year-old shot and killed, and the 8-year-old over the weekend that was killed. Our first three homicides are juveniles. Mm-hmm. That's the big picture in all of this. And the persons that shot these five students were probably juveniles.
Yes.
That's the issue.
I think we all know that.
That's the issue. And it's not to suggest that the mayor or anybody is wrong, because apparently, according to Dr. Sonia Santelisa, CEO of Baltimore City Public Schools, there has been a continuing problem where the principal has gone over to this particular Popeyes and told them about her students or his students coming to that establishment. So there's an ongoing issue. That is not, though, the problem. Mm-hmm. That's a problem, but that's not definitively the problem.
410-467-WBAL is the phone number, 410-467-9225. You can also text us on the greensolutionsremodeling.com text line at 410-467-WBAL. I said earlier, you know, what about not allowing them to actually go to Popeyes, and how is it possible that they can leave the school and then just come back if this is happening on a regular basis? We did get word that they basically have an open campus. They have two different buildings.
Correct.
The kids who are going back from one building to the next. So it's a little bit easier, I think, probably to leave at Edmondson than it is at other high schools. But still, if this is an ongoing problem, then, you know, find a solution to make sure that they stay on the campus. Like this, I don't know. I was just put off by this, that it's, you know, the guns flowing in from other places. It's Popeyes. You know, it's the private industry do all these things. You know what?
But all that's true, but that's not the part that you need to deal with right now. It's like putting all these issues that are so humongous that you can't wrap your arms around. The main problem, as you said, Brian, you have young people unmonitored going across the school. Yeah, it's a lure. Yeah, it's getting them over there, but that's not the main problem. The main problem is, why aren't we doing more to monitor these young people and dealing with them at the school?
And there's just no way that this wasn't a targeted shooting, right? I mean, it just doesn't as bad as Baltimore is, it's rare that you just have someone, you know, drive by and shoot random
people.
Look at Mervo.
Yeah, right? One high school student coming from another high school shooting and killing the young person at Mervo because of some incident. Well, joining us right now, because later on today, everyone, at 11 a.m., there will be a press conference with apparently the family members of 16-year-old Deontay Dorsey, who was tragically killed. There's another student, fighting for his life when it's in a critical condition. Mm. Three other students didn't have they were shot, but not as severe injuries. Attorney Thiru Vignarajah joins us right now because he will be speaking for the family with them over on 4600 Edmondson Avenue, corner of Swan and Edmondson. Good morning, Thiru.
Hey, Thiru.
Good morning, gentlemen. This is not the way anyone wanted to start the new year.
I wanted to say Happy New Year, but I couldn't even say that because of where we are. But go ahead, Brian.
What can you tell us about what you know about what happened and how the family is reacting?
Yeah, I mean, look, we don't know much more than the public knows at this time. Understandably, they are heartbroken in ways that only an unlucky few will ever be able to appreciate. Too many in this city, but... they're processing. They're going through the range of human emotions. This was a good kid. Deontay was a good young man, a sophomore at Edmondson, wasn't in trouble, none of that stuff. I mean, and it is very hard to process that you pack his lunch and send him to school in the morning, and you're interrupted in the middle of the day only to learn that your son may or may not be one of the victims, and then slowly but surely you learn the horrific news that your son's not coming home. They are, outraged. They are heartbroken. And there's a lot of family. And, they're all experiencing different emotions, candidly. Some of them can't speak. Some of them want to yell from the rooftops. And today is just a moment for them to, frankly, thank the community for the outpouring of support. Monique Washington, the head of the Edmondson Village Community Association, is going to be joining me. Brian and C4, you might remember, Monique and I have done, we counted, four prior press conferences at that shopping center, begging the city to do something about the open-air drug market.
That's where I was getting ready to go.
Operates unaddressed.
I wanted to go right there through. I mentioned it earlier with Brian because we were talking about it, where there had been captured on video the hand-to-hand drug dealings at the gas station right up the street and other locations in that mall. And the warning that you came on the air and told us about, through, which is right now we're talking about drug dealing. This could lead to some issues of violence. And look where we are.
No one takes pride in being right about this. 460 days ago, Monique Washington and I stood outside that Exxon gas station and said, please shut down these open air drug markets or violence is going to happen. 450 days ago, 10 days later, we returned there because a 16-year-old boy had been shot and killed around the corner from the shopping center. 260 days ago, we were there again, begging the city to shut down the open air drug market, to enforce the law, to work with the businesses there, to work with the school, because right now these kids are leaving school at all hours, buying and selling drugs in plain view on a major street, and we've done nothing about it. And we don't know the circumstances of this particular mass shooting, and let's call it what it is.
That's what it is.
A mass shooting of five high school students. I'm not even going to go to, blaming the Popeyes, which is what I heard the city's reaction was last night. What I'm going to focus on is the fact that this warning could not have been more clear. It could not have been more direct. And if you allow these circumstances to exist unfettered for years, what happened yesterday, as tragic as it was in many ways inevitable.
So we know that this is a spot where there have been drugs, as you mentioned. We know that there's been crime there. There have been shootings there in the past. Scott Wyckoff's been there. It's like, he's got all access pass there. It's been there so many times because of some type of incident. Are there cameras all around? I mean, what do police have? I mean, and do the businesses have them? Does the school have them? I know there's a church next door. What do we know about the fact that there should be, because they obviously haven't made an arrest yet, but what do we know about the potential of some type of video surveillance?
A number of the restaurants and the gas station certainly does. Some of them don't. And this is one of those circumstances where exactly where this happened, will bear on the detective's ability, and this is just drawing from my experience as a prosecutor, not any specific information about this case. So you're hopeful that one of those cameras, caught something that will lead the detectives in the right direction. Just over a year ago, I remember having long conversations with the gas station owner who had supplied these videos to police of drug transactions. I mean, I literally have a reel of them saying, please do something. We have video evidence of people selling drugs in front of our place. We can't do anything. We don't have guns and badges. You can. And look, my frustration more broadly, I know you share, but today is to remember that there is a child, you know, fighting for his or her life. There are three others that hopefully their injuries are, you know, things are going to be on the road to recovery soon. And there is a young man who will never be with us again. And he went to school, right? This is supposed to be one of the few sanctuaries. We know in America it has lost that status. But my God, you know, if this doesn't wake up the city, I don't know what will.
Thiru Vignarajah, I'm going to let you go with this, because the other part of this that we talk about consistently is the retaliatory nature of this. And while today people are mourning, we know there's going to be anger with the friends of these other teenagers, which then could lead to more violence. That's why we continue to say we've got to find a way to stop this cycle of what's happening, Thiru.
I couldn't agree more. And I will just add one substantive point here. The clearance rate last year, I know you guys heard, was something like 36%.
Yep.
And that includes all of the exceptional clearances. You can't not solve these cases. And I hope this case gets taken as seriously as the shootings in Federal Hill and Canton, because five young people were shot and one of them is dead. I urge the police department to make this a number one priority case. Frankly, they all deserve that priority.
Right.
But
we're talking about kids.
They got to solve this one.
Thank you, Thiru. Attorney Thiru Vignarajah will be with the family and parents of not just the 16-year-old Deontay Dorsey, but others up at, once again, Edmondson Village Shopping Center, right at Edmondson Avenue, 4600 Blaine, corner of Swan, 11 a.m. this morning. Thank you, Thiru.
Thanks, Thiru.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Let's take some calls on this. Let's get to Keith in Baltimore. Keith, good morning. You're on WBA with Brian and me. What are your thoughts?
Hey, how you doing?
All right, Keith.
Hey, I was over at the shopping center yesterday. I mean, no kids were out there shooting dice right before. I think I left the shopping center maybe 2 minutes before, maybe a minute before the police officer.
Mm.
But they're blaming the Popeyes, and no matter, you're in a no-win situation, because if the Popeyes call the police and tell them they have kids loitering and everything, then they're going to get on the hot list of always having incidents.
Well, that's true, but the other issue is not just out front. If they're allowing them in the stores, what the mayor is saying, in other words, we are not supposed, in the city, there's a curfew on certain ages, groups of kids going in these stores, Keith.
But see, that's what I was saying. They were not in the store. I saw them. They were out there shooting dice.
Okay.
Yeah,
that was another outlet did report that there was a game being played. And that's what I understood it to be, too. They were playing
That's not the business's responsibility.
They were right outside the business, though, and it was like, yeah. You know.
I mean, if Popeyes would have called, then they'd be just like that BP. They're always calling the police for nuisance. They become a nuisance business.
Well, I was also thinking, too, if you're the Popeyes, you're always turning around kids around, and then you're afraid that you're going to get retaliated against.
The kids nowadays, if you tell them no, then they're going to tear your business up.
But the bigger picture, Keith,
bigger
picture, Keith, since you're around LA, you know full well, and Thiru Vignarajah brought this up, we have been warning about things happening at Edmondson Village because of the nature of the drug dealing and everything else going on, Brian. And Dice, thank you for the call, Keith. Dice is just one extension of that. Like, if you allow that area to be proliferated with this activity, then you're going to get the outflows of all that other stuff. And it's been for a long time now that we haven't seen anything happen. Let's get Dennis in Bel Air. Dennis, good morning. You're on with Brian and me. Go ahead, my friend.
Good morning. Putting the onus on the Popeyes is ridiculous. The Baltimore City government, the school system, the students just being there broke rules. You probably have minimum wage people waiting, and they're going to tell somebody they're not going to serve them, and there are shootings outside. The city, you know, all the money the city got, how about putting the violence reduction people there during lunchtime?
That's a good idea.
It's just ridiculous to put the businesses as the onus, and you'll probably wind up with an empty building there if it continues.
Well, there's a lot of empty, but University of Maryland used to have a little medical stop-in facility. That's gone. It's a whole lot of empty buildings up there right now, Dennis. Thank you for the call.
I mean, you don't want to lose the Popeyes. You don't want to lose those businesses there. I mean, Arita's there. I mean, there's places where people probably go on a regular basis, and kids do too. Now they're supposed to go after school.
But if you set a tone to not allow all these other activities we're talking about, then the dice can rest. It doesn't get to this level.
I know, but if it's constantly, if you're being berate is not the right word, but if you're under pressure from the government all the time to make sure that these kids aren't doing it, and it's, now you're like, now you got to card people. You're basically like a bar. Where
but they're not the only one. But they're not the only one that does that. But this happened. It's not like it's onerous on the other places that do this. They find a way to do it in other malls around the city besides this one.
I know, but nobody's going in. They're not going anywhere. They're not going to the nail salon. They're going to the Popeyes because they can get the food there.
I got you, but I'm just saying it's not as if this isn't being done elsewhere. Let's get Will Hanna in this. Will Hanna from Park Heights. How you doing, my friend? Happy New Year, first of all.
Hey, Will.
Good morning. Good morning. Happy New Year. You know, and I you know, we constantly have these conversations about shootings, and then we'll be, you know, sometimes the shootings get missed or they get forgotten because there's another shooting the next day. Like, we're talking about this shooting when we're still not talking about the 7 or 8-year-old that was killed last. You know what I'm saying? And then next week it'll be something else because we're not going to be talking about this anymore, you know. But part of the problem that we have to consider is this. This was an automatic weapon. This was not a handgun.
That's what the witness said. By the way, real quick, before Will finishes, Brian, there was a witness that was at the library that was interviewed that had a mask on. Yeah, he said what he heard, the multiple shots, sounded like, if not an automatic weapon, something that replicated an automatic weapon. But go ahead, Will.
Yeah. And that's to part of the point is where are these kids getting automatic weapons from? And so until we're never going to solve the problem of that part. Secondly, why were these young people, you know how many shootings there are as a result of dice games in Baltimore? It's a lot.
Yes.
And I think people need to look at that and put that into some perspective. I'm not going to speculate, but just put that into some perspective that some of these things happen because they're doing things that they probably
shouldn't. But, Will, there wouldn't have been a dice game, and I'm saying this with some assurity, if there all the warnings over the last year that Edmondson Village is descending with hand-to-hand drug dealing, if you stop a lot of that, you don't get the dice game. That's my point.
That's what the communities don't have. A lot of us that work in our communities, we don't have that assurance. We see it in Park Heights at the Park Lane Shopping Center.
Yep.
Right there, Park Heights.
I know where you are.
We have the exact same issue that they have in Edmondson Village. They had the same issue that they had in East Baltimore with the shopping center over there.
Mm-hmm.
The same issues that we saw in South Baltimore. We have these same issues with all of these establishments, all of these businesses all over the city. Either the city's not helping the communities and the communities can't help themselves because a lot of people are scared to come forward in communities. They're not getting the assistance from the city that they need, and it leads to frustration. And the city is now being run by young people. This city is being run by juveniles. We're not correcting people. We're not doing anything to admonish squeezy kids. We're coddling everything. We're not doing anything to say we're going to stop dirt bikes in the city because the mayor set up a dirt bike program at a recreation center in the city when it's supposed to be illegal.
Will, thank you for the call. We've got to move on. He's 100% right. We literally have abdicated the responsibility, Brian, as adults to deal with young people's behavior that's not appropriate.
Because we've been more hands-off. We've come with new ways of them and doing
all
these things.
Let's restorative and justice and ecosystem.
You
know,
you could do that, but you still have to have tough love. It has to be there, and there has to be a consequence for your behavior. And if that means kicking you out of school or suspending you because you constantly leave school, then that's got to happen.
Let's get Maria real quick on this. Maria in Baltimore City, what are your thoughts, Maria?
Yes, so Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Yes, I wanted to say that, to talk about the government, the schools, and everything else, but it really starts at home. It starts with the parents.
You're right.
I'm 57 years old, and I had a mother was all I had from the time I was born. She died over 24 years ago. And it all starts at home with parents disciplining their children and teaching them right from wrong, teaching them how to have respect for authority. I went to the Mel Junior High School back in the 70s and also Frederick Douglass back in the 80s. And my mother raised me. I love school, and I still think about school today, but I better not even think about leaving out of the school and go up Mondawmin or anywhere else. Because she would deal me.
You would do it once. You would do it once, and that would be it.
I better not. I remember when I was in the 7th grade, and I was going to LaMelle, and had some children, some girls, say, come on, Maria, let's leave. Let's go up Mount Diamond. I said, oh, no, I'm not.
Well, Maria, thank you very much. Happy, but move on. Happy New Year. But Maria's right. There is a parental role in this, Brian.